Pittsburgh Sports Line. Thanks for watching our show. We have a lot of sports action here today, as usual. Like I always say, we have a lot of great information here for you. And I'm going to start out with, I'm going to promote this. Chip, I may need your hand here. I got to read one here. Jimmy Savetic did the Golden Gloves, and they gave us his black and gold bouts. The Kumite Classic is at the Monroeville Convention Center. General admission is $20, ringside $30. It's just a great event. It's May 24th, and it opens up at 4 p.m., fight times at 7:30. So if you can be there, check that out. And then I got to go to some of my usual. We had our Butler Wobble guy, Dave Crack. He represents Butler Wobble. He corrected me on Pittsburgh Sportsline on Facebook that it's not just him. Well, he was the representative. Dave, you can't take it so literal here. We have a little bit of fun. You were a great guy. He brought two unicycles, Big Mike. Awesome. You have to watch the video. It's up there right now. And this is the event that will be in Butler around Moraine State Park and everything, July 21st to the 27th. Check out the video with Dave. It's a great thing. Now, we always start with what's on our mind, but one of our hosts was stuck in traffic. So we may go, if Smoke and Jim's in the house, we're going to hit a commercial right now, and then we'll do what's on our mind. We always have our edition, What's on Our Mind, and I'm Al Levine, the talking machine. We got Chip the Prophet Hainer, Smoke and Jim Frazier just come in. His limo driver actually stopped at the bathroom first. That's why he was a little late. And Big Mike Butera is going to start it off with, what's on your mind?
Thank you, machine and co-host. I was told I was allowed to do a shameless promo, and it's not shameless, actually, because it's for the Tri-County Thoroughbred Corral. It's a Mustang Club, I was honored to have Devin Shea, our guy behind the cameras, join the club this weekend, as he is an owner of a Mustang, as I am.
First interruption, congratulations, Devin. He's also working the cameras right now, and he's doing a swell job on your new haircut there, Big Mike.
Got to brush off some of the hair. And they actually voted on him to allow him to join the club on Saturday night, in spite of the fact that he was a friend of mine, which... Devin, you can attest to.
Was it unanimous?
Because you didn't admit to it.
I introduced it to the crowd. I wanted to give my TCTC, Tri County Thoroughbred Corral. Sunday, August 11th, we have our annual car cruise at Falcone Ford in Moon Township. It's not just for Mustangs, it's for anything. You can bring any car you want if you want to show it. There are prizes, food, entertainment, and a variety of cars to be seen, and we're all wondering what's going on. Yeah.
However, this is live TV, folks. We're getting a little feedback on some of these microphones, like the one in our ears. We're getting some feedback on that right now, so we're working that situation out. Looks like Mike's headset fell on the floor there.
Got it. Moving along, I wanted to congratulate the law authority universally, because as we spoke last week, those bad actors were killed and or captured in the city of Boston. And that's a shout out to police and law enforcement and FBI and all that jazz. Job well done. And this just in, David Ortiz is the, even though he's from the Dominican, he owns the city of Boston. That's what I found out via television. If in case you didn't see it, David Ortiz, that's our city, blah, blah, blah. Okay, David Ortiz, he's a thing, you know. Designated hitter, which I don't consider to be a ball player. Yesterday, Monday, was the 43rd annual Earth Day, celebrated nationally. I just found out about it today. I didn't know it was yesterday. But nonetheless, it was.
You were listening to that David Ortiz tape.
Over and over again. Yeah. I'm going to learn how to speak English. And it was celebrated pretty much universally at Major League Baseball parks. Example, in Boston, owned by David Ortiz, it was a carbon neutral game. Now, I had to look up what carbon neutral meant. I can't figure it out, but here's what the Red Sox did. They bought some energy credits so that they could offset the energy that they use. Pretty cool. I hope so. When the A's visited the Red Sox, it was again designated the carbon neutral game. The Twins, they gave out to the first 10,000 people rain gauge devices so that the people could gauge the rain. That would be too obvious. The Reds.
You didn't just say that. I have to interrupt you on that.
I thought that, okay. Well, I did just say it. It'll be on tape. The Reds. The Reds, a rain gauge. Come on, what is it?
It's a gauge of rain.
Exactly. Yeah, it's like a tire pressure thing. You stick it in your tire.
So. Folks, this is a sports talk show. It's not an educational show. Sometimes we do come up with educational stuff. And you can call in 412-831-3304. Ask for Big Mike, not me, please.
The Reds opened a series against the Cubs, and theirs was to recycle old electronics. I guess you show up with an electronic piece and you throw it in. The Phillies Go Green program employees had an earth cleanup day at Franklin Delano Roosevelt Park. And for each home run hit by a Phillies player this season, home or away, a tree will be planted as part of the Plant 1 Million Tree campaign. Trees can be planted anywhere, obviously, or they can be planted in Philadelphia, one or the other. The Cardinals will host the fourth annual Green Week, and they are also recycling electronics and giving donations. The Rays open a three-game series against the Yankees, and theirs is crazy. It says, Bat Watch Rays Hat and Benefit a Bat Plant a Ball program. What does plant a ball mean? I have no clue.
Where at?
Again, this would be somewhere in Tampa Bay.
I have to ask you a question. You're not going to do all 52 baseball teams.
I got two more to go before I get to the one that you got that we're all interested in, and that will be the Pirates. So hold your breath. I'm getting close.
We already know that they're going to transplant the green weenie. Okay, so we already know.
Where?
We're at?
Where?
It's up to your mind. And if you're going in the gutter.
In Seattle, see? This is probably one of the best ones. In Seattle, Mariners ace Felix Hernandez is promoting a campaign encouraging fans to compost at home. Compost at home.
Well, at least we found out where.
At home. The Rockies. I'm getting the hurry up. The Rockies have a green initiative of a positive impact on the environment.
But the Pirates were lauded, and I mean lauded, both Pirates and Bob Nutting, and that's where I was getting to, as being the most green
weenies. And your point of all this was, sir?
Don't ask.
Oh, sorry.
He's gonna twist the head off his chipper doll.
Well, his arm looks like it's all bound up. His skin's getting very bad. I'm gonna take him to St. Clair Hospital after this. Mm-hmm. Look at that arm. Try not to get that on TV. Thanks, Big Mike.
That was some of the most research that you did. Sunday night.
All right, Smoking Jim. What's on your mind?
Hey, thanks, Al Levine, the talking machine. And if you want the green, you got to see Levine. And, hey, I'm looking forward to the car crews coming out to support the Mustangs and my main man, Devin, and Big Mike. Real quick, my spotlight player of the week. The NFL scouts most likely do not do their job because this guy is not being ranked anywhere. He's not on anybody's watch list. Nobody's heard of him. He wasn't invited to the combine. If the NFL scouts around the country would do their job, this guy would be a first-round draft choice and a multimillionaire. His name is Charles Johnson, and you know if your name's Charles Johnson, you must be a wide receiver. The Steelers had a wide receiver by that name in 94, first-round draft choice from Colorado. This young man is out of Grand Valley State, a Division II school, 6'2", 215 pounds, excellent size. His speed is 4.35 in the 40. Ooh. Tremendously productive guy. As a senior, he had 72 catches, over 1,000 yards, 16 touchdowns. I call him Charles Bubble Screen Johnson because they sure threw a lot of bubble screens to him, so he fits right in with the Pittsburgh Steelers offense and the bubble screens, but he can make all the catch. Super athletic guy, 40-inch vertical jump. And that's my spotlight player of the week. He kind of reminds me of Jimmy Smith, the former Jacksonville Jaguar wide receiver when I scouted him at Jackson State. So my spotlight player of the week this week is Grand Valley State superstar Charles Johnson. Keep an eye on him.
Thanks, we'll Smoking Jim. We'll go revisit some of that, and we'll have a special edition for the NFL draft here. I have something lined up for
right,
we'll discuss on that later on. All right, Chip the Prophet Hainer, what's on your mind?
What's on my mind? Thank you, Alan. Here's what's on my mind. Last night, the Penguins played the Senators. There's a big build-up to this game, how there was going to be blood that Chris Neal from the Senators was going to beat up Matt Cook, and everybody said that Matt Cook doesn't deserve to be in the game, and because he accidentally injured one of the Senators' top players, accidentally cut his Achilles tendon with his skate when they played back in February, and it just kind of goes to show what happens when you try to retaliate in professional sports, because here's a team, the Ottawa Senators, that are fighting for a playoff spot. They're tied for eighth place in the playoff race, and there are teams that are vying for that position. And one of them, the Winnipeg Jets, 1 point behind them. Last night, the Ottawa Senators needed those 2 points, but instead of concentrating on winning the hockey game, they spent the time trying to pick fights with everybody on the ice, including Matt Cook. And Matt Cook, I applaud him for not being baited into fighting. Matt Cook was more value to his team on the ice playing than he would have been in a penalty box or getting injured. Look at all the rest of the Penguins that are injured. And Chris Neal, he's a guy that can actually play hockey, but he's their thug. He's their goon. He went around trying to pick fights with everybody until Dan Bylsma put the Penguins goon out on the ice, Steve McIntyre. Now, to preface where Steve McIntyre came from, go to YouTube. Type his name in, Steve McIntyre. He took on the whole entire team in minor league hockey. He wanted to fight everybody on the bench, the coaches. He even wanted to pick on the farm team. This guy is a monster. He's got no hockey skills at all. Bylsma brought him up to protect his players. And you know what? I think it was a great thing for him to do, because this is the environment that hockey has, condoned. Right. And then, on top of that, Hockey did enough of giving itself a black eye this past year by locking out the players. Well, now, you know, you take the two guys that are on the national telecast for the NBC. What's his name?
No,
Mike Mailberry and Jeremy Roenick. Two buffoons. These two guys get on national TV and talk about how Matt Cook was a freaking skunk and that he deserves to get beat up by anybody on the Senators. And if they don't do it, then you know, somebody on some other team should. Well, that's great. That's the kind of image you want to project to children and to the rest of the nation who don't really know much about hockey. Hockey's a niche sport, and it's never going to go nationwide with that kind of Neanderthal thinking. NBC needs to get rid of those two clowns and get somebody in there that can actually bring some excitement and give you some useful information into the game. You know, poor Mike Milbury's still crying because Ulfie Samuelson crushed Cam Neely back in the 91 playoffs. So he's got an axe to grind against the Penguins. But that's what's on my mind.
Holy Christ. Get a fire extinguisher.
Hold on, wait. Let me get a little towel to cool down.
I'm telling you.
I don't know if
the
you
heat
guys
is
saw.
On.
Whoa. We'll get the Brenner contracting.
Oh, man.
We'll see. After that, I lost what was on my mind. One thing I don't know about Milbury, I'm not going to revisit your thing. Yes, I am.
Go ahead.
Milbury. His son was playing hockey.
Oh, yeah, that's
and
right.
And he was pushing and shoving a kid, knocking a kid around.
No, he's the same guy that threatened a 12-year-old.
Right.
Okay?
Oh, that
class
was
act.
That was the guy. And there may be video that he actually pushed a kid or two around.
Well, you know.
So how does that
Matt Cook's got a bad reputation.
He
had, and it was well-deserved. But in the last couple of years, he's really changed the way he's played the game.
Right.
Because somebody sat him down and said, look, if you want to stay in the NHL.
Well, Mario did tell him.
They, you know, you need to change the way you play. Because Matt Cook is actually a very good hockey player. Yeah. He's an asset to any team he plays for. But, you know, I mean, that reputation of his, he's going to carry that around with him for the rest of his life. So, you know what? He has made some changes in the way he's played his game,
right,
because he wants to play the game, and he has some appreciation for it. So,
all right, now I know what's on my mind. Thanks to Don Campiti. I don't know if you guys in the South Hills and even the surrounding area ever heard of Campiti's, but that's up on Potomac Avenue and going to Keystone Oaks. That was a pretty nice place to get your pizza and hang out for a little while. We did that plenty of times, and Don, I've seen him over the years, so have a nice night, Don. I hope you're having some of that Campiti pizza, because they do have a special at Sip Sports Bar tonight, and your pizza's being served there, so that's pretty cool.
Really?
We'll talk about some Sip stuff in a couple minutes, but I did want to give a shout-out to him and Chief, because before they start watching the baseball, because it's Bucks and Pucks tonight. Now, normally, Root Sports got me started on that because they'd have the late game out in L.A. or Arizona. So I just like Bucks and Pucks. And I told my sister, Hope, you know, the biggest fan that's in New Jersey. I talked to her today. She said hi to Chip, Smoking Jim, and Big Mike.
I got a shout out.
She said, hello there. And I've sent her each video. She's a little bit behind on it, so she's giving me ideas for the show, but she's about 3-4 weeks behind. She asked about Russell Shell. And if we talked about him, I said, yeah, that's old news. She goes, what I thought.
Well, you know,
and then hockey, she goes, I can't really see the Penguins or the Pirates. And then her husband, Gary, the second biggest fan in Jersey, he goes, it's on the NHL Network, and they're playing the Phillies tonight. So guess what? We're going to watch Bucks and Pucks.
Wow.
So we understand if you're not watching the show, go to Pittsburgh Sportsline. You'll see it up in a day or so. Or if you want to hang with us, call in 412-831-3304. I want to know why you're not watching the Bucks or the Pucks. And we're going to revisit what we all talked about here. I wanted to touch base with Big Mike a little bit since I interrupted him with the green weenie thing. But since Bob Prince started that, I thought that would be a great recycling type of thing on Earth Day.
Am I allowed to talk about Earth Day?
Well, you found out late. I knew about it a week ahead of time. So,
yeah, that'd be an awesome idea, Machine. Honest to goodness. But again, I want to, and you know pretty much where I stand with the upper level of the Pirates. But I do want to give a shout out to Bob Nutting, because believe me, out of the three papers that I use that are recycled, three pages of paper that are recycled, the biggest shout out was to Nutting in particular and the Pittsburgh Pirates organization. So go green weenie, go raise the jolly Dodger.
It's a Dodger.
And continued success to the Pirates on the field.
Yes.
And I was drinking Kool-Aid last night, just so you
and
know.
Speaking awesome. Of Kool-Aid, you know, I've been making the Pirate Kool-Aid and I've been passing it around. Well, last night I got Jim and I got Alan to make their own Pirate Kool-Aid. So now you shall be bestowed with your own Pirate Kool-Aid.
I drank mine on air.
So Big Mike, you can start making your own Pirate Kool-Aid because...
Else was a little sour.
I want to tell you, it was a little sour.
Add sugar. Sweeten it up a little bit.
Awesome. Thank
and
you.
And I said it was fine.
But hey, you know, just to go back to I was talking about how the retaliations get you nowhere. And the best way to retaliate against a team that you've got a grudge against is to simply just kick their butts.
Right.
The example that I'd like to put out is last year, Chapman, the fireballer reliever for the Reds, plunked Andrew McCutchen. And everybody said, you know, that they were upset that the Pirates didn't retaliate. And the first time the Pirates and the Reds played this year, everybody's shouting, you know, they have to retaliate, they have to retaliate. Well, guess what? They retaliated by sweeping them 3 games in a row. And nobody got ejected. Nobody got hit. And I think that speaks much more clearly than any kind of physical act against a member of the other team.
Good point. Anybody else have any revisitations they want to discuss here?
Yeah. I like the bit about Matt Cook. And he is the typical, or is it atypical? No, he is the typical, prototypical type of player that you like to have on your team. But you don't like him to be playing against the team that is your favorite team, and that's just historical.
Well said,
probably,
mm-hmm.
It is. Thank you. It probably is more so in hockey than any other sport because hockey has 81 games as opposed to the 16 game schedule in the NFL. Baseball, you don't have what do you call it?
162.
Thugs or. Or
enforcers,
enforcers. So hockey is probably the sport that really gets into that enforcer jazz, the bad actor, or not the bad actor per se, but the player on a team that the people just want to see crushed. Or if you got them, you want them on your team. You know,
roller derby.
To speak to that point, you know, I mean, when you watch Olympic hockey, you know, you watch the Olympic hockey tournaments, and those tournaments are really exciting to watch, and you see some of the best hockey that you'll ever see. They play on a little bit larger of ice surface, but fighting is banned. And I tell you what, the game flows more freely, and it's a lot more enjoyable to watch. And I think with all the concern that people are making in all the professional sports about head injuries and stuff like that, they ought to move towards eliminating fighting from hockey. And I'm an old school hockey fan, but you know what? Times are changing. And, you know, if the sport wants to continue to grow and become popular, it's going to change with the times.
Is it bigger ice in the Olympics?
Yes.
It's bigger. And this is what you're saying about you can't eliminate that jazz in hockey goes back to something we discussed probably late last year about steroids in sports. If you wanted to do it, they could do it. Zero tolerance.
Well, you know, and here's another point. You know, the owner of the Senators is the one that kept on running his mouth and going on and on, and even so put a so-called bounty on Matt Cook. And here's the thing: the commissioner of the NHL. What does he do about that? David Stern, as much as I, you know, he's another of these commissioners that really doesn't do much of anything. He would have fined that owner at least $500,000. Now that's, you know, these guys that are billionaires, what's a $500,000? But the commissioner doesn't even do anything to step in to say anything. So, you know what, it's like the inmates are running the asylum.
You know, it's funny you mentioned a commissioner fining an owner. Do you remember when Steinbrenner was actually effectively out of the game for a year? And back in the late 70s, I forget, he was betting or gambling or something, and he got banned. He was not allowed in a major league ballpark into the Yankees offices for a year. And then there was another sport, I can't remember, where the owner was bounced too. So, you know,
about Jerry Kramer in football.
Well, yeah, but I'm talking about ownership because you said $500,000. What's it to an owner?
Yeah, like Mark Cuban. He's a multi-billionaire. Yeah. He's been fined how many times by the commissioner?
Except for one
basketball
thing. Every time he's fined, he donates the same amount of money of a fine to somewhere else.
To charity.
So you can't beat that.
I never seen him donate nothing to the United Negro College Fund.
How do you know? He doesn't publicize all of his things.
And George Steinbrenner was a big donator as well. But that's where you get him. If you how bad do you think a punishment that would be on Mark Cuban if he wasn't allowed to attend his basketball games?
Roger Goodell would never punish.
The way his team played this year, maybe not.
Roger Goodell would never punish one of the owners. Yeah, he did punish the management of the Saints, you know, but. You know, we've got the draft coming up Thursday night. You know how Rodgers getting in his kinder, gentler NFL that he's got.
We'll touch on that in the draft part of this.
Hugging all the brothers.
Instead of shaking your hand, he's hugging the guys when they're drafted. Hey, Roger, why don't you just get a room?
All right, we're going to go to our next segment. I think we revisited stuff that wasn't revisited. So. All right, Sip Sports Bar. Great night last night. Great guests. We had Lightning Rod Salka, who's fighting on May 3rd.
World champion.
Yes. And you can, again, go to Pittsburgh Sportsline on Facebook. Check back. You can see his belt. He brought it to the show. He didn't bring it last night, but we didn't ask. And Rod spent the last 15 minutes of the show with us telling us how I know Bethel Park. He's in South Park, but it's getting closer here. So the champion's getting right in the neighborhood here. So we'll see him again. We had Dave Crack with the unicycle and the Butler Wobble. I mean, he was a great guest. He explained all of it. And we may even have Stephanie Hayner going and trying out the unicycle. And their buddy Mike Brown's going to try that.
And to describe what a wobble is a group of people on unicycles.
Wow.
So not on crack.
But that's what a wobble is a group of people on unicycles. So that was something that I learned last night.
And not to make fun of his name, but you know we have locker room humor here, not in a bad sense, but, you know, we do get a little silly. And Dave had a great story, so I'm just going to tease you. Go watch the video of it, or if you can watch it on TV, Verizon 32, anybody else watching this, Comcast 7 in Bethel Park, we're getting people all throughout the city. Anywhere on Verizon, we're getting great reports, Big Mike. We're getting fans every day.
How far up are we now?
Well, we're at 222. On the Pittsburgh Sportsline Facebook page, but we're in the thousands in the neighborhoods.
Awesome.
And you didn't even acknowledge your friends that are watching.
Rick and Loretta, they always watch them.
Okay, well, at least we're still at two there. So
and all the rest of the
But anyhow, it sips. I want to tell you, Tuesday nights, 50 cents a slice of pizza for Campiti's Pizza. You got to get it with pepperoni, because Chip and I were reminiscing how it curls up, it sort of burn on there, and it's like when you throw it in a frying pan.
Oh, man, it's like...
And thanks to Fortina giving us this information. You got to see Tracy there, best waitress, bartender in the downtown Dormont. And that's Tracy with an EY. You can hear her give her story about how a guy found our show. You got to listen to that and watch it. Then Thursday night, Jumbo Wings.
What night?
Thursday night, 25 cent smoking. And then Friday, they got the jumbo $7.50 jumbo fish sandwich with coleslaw just for smoking, Jim. And they have entertainment on Saturday nights. Get there about 8 o'clock. But it's a great place. We're getting more people are coming out. A lot of great guests will be coming in the next couple weeks. We're planning on more boxing guests coming out. And we'll see what happens with the championships, I think, in Reading. There might be some this week. So we may get a couple other boxers coming out with new championship boxing belts. All right, now we go to some of my favorite segments. We'll start out with Fiction and Fact from Smokin' Jim's Almanac.
Thanks, Al Levine, the talking machine. I appreciate that, and I can't wait for Thursday night jumbo wings. But hey, I'm going back to 2000. Everybody knows I'm NFL scout. I'll be with the Steelers Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, helping them bring in brand new players here in the city. This will be my 11th year in a row, but it's really my 12th year because I was fired after the 2000 season. I got to go all the way back to 2000. Last year, Three River Stadium. I tell you what, I get in there, it's like Fort Knox, man. You get into Three River Stadium, if you remember way back in 2000, that's when my main man, Bill Cowher, was really under the gun with the media. They say he was running around on his wife. He was cheating with Cordell's sister and all that stuff. I never did believe that. Get in there and I see Bill Cowher for the first time. He got one of those designer sweaters on. And I'm saying to myself, wow, Bill Cowher looks a lot better in person than he does on TV. Then I started seeing all these beautiful young interns running around. And I thought, yeah, he's cheating. But hey.
and that's his friend, folks.
and that was the first year for Kevin Colbert. And him and Bill Cowher put all their marbles in one basket. And that was Plexico Burris. Kevin Colbert came from a successful career where he took down the Detroit Lions from the top to the bottom. And so he had experience. Plexico was at Michigan State. He had all kind of red flags around him, and they really wanted to draft him. They had a dinner meeting with him on the Friday prior to the draft, a week before the draft. They went down to Michigan State. Plexico overslept, so they took him off his board. But he met with him the next day and conned the Steelers in the drafting him with the eighth pick. The problem started with me when the Steelers took a nose guard, Kendrick Clancy, from Mississippi, who couldn't spell cat if you spotted him the C and the T. Me and John Mitchell, the defensive line coach, kind of had words. And then right after that, they drafted Chris Combs, defensive end from Duke. And me and John Mitchell, we really went at it. Pittsburgh Steelers had enough of me and didn't invite me back for the next 2 years and still until Kendrick Clancy and Chris Combs became two of the biggest busts in Steeler history. So I came back in 2003 and I'll be back this week. So that's your fiction and fact from Smoking Jim's Almanac.
Thank you. Thank you, Smoking Jim. And now we go to Chip's trivia time.
Hey, thank you, awesome, Alan. But, you know, hey, Smoking Jim, you got to give credit where credit is due. And Kevin Colbert was only one of the people that helped destroy the Lions. Let's not forget about Matt Millen. Okay, Matt Millen may have been a great Penn Stater.
And yes, great, he was great.
Great linebacker and won some Super Bowls. He was the worst executive in NFL history, bar none. Okay? Yeah. Bar none. But, Chip's trivia. I dug into my fountain of useless information.
I saw his fountain, folks.
Yeah, and you know that the number 21 has been retired here in the city of Pittsburgh by the Pittsburgh Pirates. Nobody will ever wear that number again. But there was one other Pittsburgh Pirate that wore that number in the history of the Pirates franchise.
Billy Meyer?
No, it was Archie Vaughn. Archie Vaughn wore it from 1932 to 1939.
Wow.
Okay.
Wow.
So that's the only other person that can lay claim to doing that. Other useless bits of information. Today, in 1939, a rookie hit his first home run. The rookie's name was Ted Williams.
Everybody knows. Wow.
Everybody's heard of him. And, you know, I've always been one to always complain about the pitch count in baseball.
Right.
You know, it drives me crazy. A guy throws 80, 90, you know, A.J. Burnett last night, 5 innings, he threw 100 pitches, he was done. Well, you know, I look back into the Hall of Fame and I talk about how the guys in the old days would throw, you know, pitch doubleheaders. Well, here's an interesting little useless piece of information. Back in 1913, a Hall of Fame pitcher for the New York Giants, Christy Mathewson, pitched a complete game, beat the Phillies 3-1, threw 67 pitches in the whole game. Now that's what you call being a master of your craft.
That's efficient.
I mean, that's unheard of. You see some guys at 3 innings and they've got 67 pitches. Okay, back in 1876, Joe Borden won the first National League Baseball game. Joe Borden was the starting pitcher for Boston, and they beat the Phillies that day. Also on this date, in 1962, the 0-9 New York Mets, an expansion franchise, won their first baseball game. They did that by beating the Pittsburgh Pirates.
What year?
1962.
Before your time.
Almost.
And this one, I pulled this one out for Big Mike Butera.
Okay.
Because I know he bleeds Yankee blue.
Look at his arm.
That's every week.
Look at his arm.
On Earth Day in 1915, okay, on 4/22, 1915 was the first time that pinstripes appeared on Yankees uniform.
Really? 1915.
Wow. April 22nd, 1915. I got that one for you, Ben.
Did they have numbers on them back then?
No, they didn't start that till the 20s, and that's the numbers were designated for at least the Yankees in the way they were batting. In other words, Ruth was number three because he batted third ahead of Gehrig, number four.
Oh, really?
Yes. Yeah, that's the way that started on the Yankees.
You got fiction in fact. From Big Mike's almanac with an assist.
From Chipper.
Chipper and yeah. Howard.
I rob you them Yankee softball.
And Chipper, let it be known that I love him again. I'm putting his bobblehead back together. You did that for me. I can't twist him. You know what I mean?
Those are my useless little bits of information.
Thanks, Chip. We appreciate it. I know I do. If the others don't, but we do have some fans out there that enjoy that. And now we're going with a new segment here. I got an email. I'm not going to reveal what was said in it. That we're going to have a new segment with Big Mike.
Trial.
All right.
This is he's on probation right
probie.
Now.
I'm a probie.
So this is Big Mike's questions.
It's questions because I want to get this
you
is
want answers.
You can't handle the answers. I want interactivity from these guys. And there's going to be a soft toss. There's going to be a medium ball, and then there's going to be a fastball. And it's all sports-related because, let's face it, folks, this is a sports show. Okay, let's start off with a medium toss. And these tonight, potpourri, with a T, soft T. Tonight, this first one is basketball, okay? And that's quotation night tonight. And the quotation is, when my time on earth is gone and my activities here are past, I want them to bury me upside down, bury me, and my critics can kiss my ass.
Bob Knight.
There you go. See, that was a medium toss, okay? Hardball toss. Again, sports related. The fewer rules a coach has, the fewer rules there are for the players to break. Tick, tock, tick, tock, tick, tock.
You got me on
okay,
that one.
The fewer rules a coach has, the fewer rules there are for players to break. John Madden. Wow. John Madden.
Well, because they had the gang of criminals over there in Oakland.
Yeah, they only had a couple rules.
Okay, soft toss. Do you guys want soft toss basketball or football?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. What's the difference? No, that's a hard toss. Okay, soft toss. We talking about practice?
That's Allen Iverson.
There you go. There it is, folks.
There's Big Mike's still questions. He's going to go. We'll bring us back next week.
Awesome, man. Thanks, pals.
All right.
That was good.
Now we're going to go to NFL draft expert, Smoking Jim Frazier, and we'll try to add in some of our stuff. Hold it. He got an announcement coming in, folks. One of his sponsors that helps him out with the draft, he's signing a deal right now. I think he's writing a book.
I'm good.
Are you writing a book this week?
The questions are out there. I mean, the Steelers' needs are many. Where do they go with the first pick? I mean, it's like you've got 10 fingers and 10 toes, and you've got 40 holes in the dike. Which ones are you going to plug?
What's your first pick? What do you think we need first?
You know, if I have my wish list, well, here's how I think the draft is going to unfold, there's not going to be a whole lot of activities, but I think you're going to see a surprise in the draft in the form of, that Darrell Revis just left the Jets for Tampa Bay, so the Jets picked up another first-round pick. So the Jets got pick 9 and 13. Mm-hmm. Pick number 8 now is the Buffalo Bills, and they have a first-year coach in from Syracuse. And he really wants to draft his guy, his quarterback, Ryan Nassar, with the 8th pick. Now, most people picked him to go in the 3rd or 4th round.
Yeah.
But he's moving up the draft boards a little bit in the 2nd round. The Jets have already put out that they like Ryan. So if he tries to move back, if Buffalo tries to move back, they may lose him to the Jets, their pick to the Jets from 9 or 13. So look for Buffalo to upset the apple cart and take a player who's projected to go way back. Then you remember Minnesota did that a couple years ago with Pinter, the quarterback, Ponder.
Yeah.
And that kind of will unravel.
Cause a domino effect.
It
changed the whole complexion of how they were drafted.
Yes, it does. What I'm going to suggest for the Pittsburgh Steelers is I believe that the Steelers really need a player who can play more than one position. A guy that has a, provides a lot of versatility, and that player, even though he's small, is Tavon Austin from West Virginia. Tavon Austin is 5'9", 180 pounds roughly, super fast, super quick. Now, you got to realize this guy, when he was in high school, was a running back, 8,000 yards, 123 touchdowns, Dunbar High School. Now, in college, he should have won the Heisman Trophy for what he did in college. But you, if you look at him at West Virginia, over 100 catches last year, nearly 20 touchdowns, returns punt and kickoffs. The Steelers need to get Brown off of punt and kickoff returns. This guy can do it. He can cover punts and kickoffs for you. Also, the Steelers need a guy like Percy Harvin who can come in four or five plays a game and give you a slash scare at running back. This is a guy that can come in as your third down back and scare that defense. So you can bring him in on third down four or five times, giving four or five touches in the backfield. Last year against a tough Oklahoma defense, West Virginia put him in a tailback because they had no other option, a tailback, and he ran for a school record, a conference record, 350 yards against Oklahoma. So this is a guy that I would pick if I was, if I had the choice. At 17, that would be my guy.
You know, that's interesting that you mentioned that, because I was listening to an interview with Charlie Casserly, who at one point was a general manager in the NFL, and he now works for the NFL Network. And I was listening to an interview with him last week. And that's, believe it or not, that's who he said that the Steelers might end up taking. And for a lot of the same reasons that, that you, because now Antonio Brown's now been elevated to the number one receiver's position, you know, so you cannot risk having him hurt on returning kicks. And, you know, and we've all seen it. The Steelers have been burned by it time and time again. Another team changing the outcome of the game by splash plays, as Coach Cowher says.
You know, Tomlin.
Coach Tomlin. But yeah, no,
you're
but
thinking I, back to what Smoking Jim said, because he's
drinking,
a friend.
I was drinking Jim's Cowher Kool-Aid.
Cowher Power Kool-Aid.
Yeah, but, you know, so, you know, that that sounds like it would, you know, it would make a lot of sense. But, you know, the question I have for you, Jim, is I know that Geno Smith's stock has kind of been raising in the draft. And where do you think that he might go in the draft? Do you think he's going to go high in the draft?
Well, I wouldn't take Geno Smith if I had the 12th pick in the 12th round of, the, of the draft pick. You know, he's not my kind of quarterback. He don't have any fire. Reminds me of Dennis Dixon, who the Steelers had as their third string quarterback. I like a fire and brimstone. I like a quarterback that's getting and take over the huddle. He can't do that, but he does got a lot of talent. And it is a sort of a weak year at the top for quarterbacks. And I think that look for maybe somebody to move up, because if he doesn't go in the top 10 or 12, meaning Buffalo, I don't think he got the arm strength to throw in Buffalo or in the Windy City of New Jersey. I think that somebody will move up into that 20, 25 round range right there. The problem with Geno Smith is you're getting a lot of conflicting reports. Now what teams are doing, they're not only meeting with players, they're meeting with their family. Like that is going to be the reason why, you know, oh, he comes from a good family, so we draft him. They need to meet with the, his boys from the hood to find out where his posse is. But I think that Geno Smith, there's conflicting reports. Some say he's a workout warrior. Some say that he watches a lot of film. And others say you can't find him.
My thoughts are, and I've heard some rumblings, you know, that they, you know, he, you know, people look to him to be the dark horse like Russell Wilson was last year, or Colin Kaepernick. I mean, he's, you know, he would be more of a read option type quarterback instead of your classic drop back passer.
Well, you know, they're talking about maybe Philadelphia Eagles. I don't know why. You know, they, I guess they want to lead the league in black quarterbacks. But they say Philadelphia may move up in the 20s. If he falls past 15 or 18, Philadelphia may move up to get him, to team him up with his older brother, Dennis Dixon, who is also on that roster.
Well, you know, and I hear rumblings that, you know, Chip Kelly in Philadelphia is going to revolutionize the game. I, you know, I don't know if his circus act from Oregon is going to translate well into the NFL now that everybody's seen these you know, read options offenses. I don't think they're going to be as successful as they were in the past because defensive coordinators probably haven't slept a wink in this offseason. They're devising game plans to minimize their effectiveness.
Well, it's real easy to stop the read option, kill the quarterback. You start killing the quarterback, and that stops it right there. And that ball draws a crowd. And I think the coordinators are going to start saying that, hey, you know, we're going to start hammering the quarterback. You see what happened in Washington.
Yeah, you know, and we saw what happened to RG3, but, you know, with the way the rules are protecting the quarterbacks, you know, how's that going to work against an aggressive defense? Because, you know, they bit the Steelers in the back end a number of times because they're starting to, you know, protect the high-profile offensive players.
Well, the one thing about the NFL and there are certain quarterbacks that are allowed to get hit, and certain ones are.
Well, yeah, Ben can get molested. Yeah, he can get mauled.
Yeah, he can.
But they're not going to ever throw a flag.
But I think that they'll be a little bit more lenient on the defense because these guys in a read option, it looks like they're in a running mode, so they're not a quarterback. They are essentially a running back. So I think if some of these smart coaches get to the referees like Belichick does and talks to the referees before the game and say, hey, how are you going to call this? This guy's actually a running back at this particular point. You know, we're going to have to hit him. And the referee says, okay, hey, no problem. You know, I'll pay you $5,000 in a cruise.
The way they've got the rules slated, you know, like they're going to say if he's in between the tackles that he's still considered a quarterback.
Yeah.
I mean, the rules are so much up to interpretation. Yeah. One crew's going to call it one way, another crew's going to call it another way. And then if they have to make a snap call, nobody's going to make any call because they don't want to be overturned on replay.
And then you got a guy that just retired that's never been fined before in his life, and he's going to Canton, is Ray Lewis. So there's some guys that they've never been fined for, and they've been very, very aggressive their whole career. So certain guys, when they wear the white suits.
Yeah, I know. They remember.
And you're wearing the white hat.
The white hat.
He got the white hat.
On the Lone Ranger.
Ray was the one that walked away from it, man.
I need Tano for the rain gauge, though.
I think you got Tano next to you. Tano looks like a little red face next to you there, like he was out in the sun a little bit. What else do you think they need, like with defense? They're talking it's hard to get a rookie to play on the Steeler defense. Are there any rookies that you see, linebacker or some, or that white safety you're looking for out there?
Anybody? Corner,
I'm sorry.
But, you know, if I'm the Pittsburgh Steelers, I'm drafting offensive line, offensive line, offensive line, offensive line. I'm trading all my – I'm getting picks for next year for offensive line. But the problem is Pittsburgh Steelers are real high on – we talking crack? Mike Adams. And they're real high on the other fat guy from the year before.
Marcus Gilbert.
So they think that – so they can't draft high on the offensive line because they've invested in those two bums. So they have to live and die with them. So defensively, in a draft, of course, I'm very high on Manti Te'o. We got a lot in common. Hi, Brazil.
She's in studio again.
This is a guy that's been tremendously productive for 4 years at Notre Dame. Granted, he had one bad game, but a lot of guys have a bad game. But over 400 tackles, over 100 tackles a year. They said going into last year he was going to be one of the first linebackers taken, but they said you have to work on your pass defense. So he went out there and was second in the nation in interceptions with 7 interceptions this year. The guy is just a football player. I haven't seen a Samoan that couldn't play football. He's a guy that I would draft and bring in and just have somebody monitor his computer system.
Thanks, man.
No hacking.
We appreciate that. And with the way the Pirates have been playing, I'd be remiss if I didn't bring up the Pirates, the chip here.
Well, you know what? The Pirates brought up Brandon Inge today, and they're starting him at third base.
In place of who?
Well, they sat Pedro for the evening, and Pedro Alvarez hit his third home run in the last 5 games last night.
He needs a rest.
You know, he's starting to make contact with the ball.
So you rest him.
So, you know, I mean, but the purpose of bringing in Inge is he's a veteran presence on the bench.
Right.
That can, you know, he produces a lot of intangibles that may not show up on the scorecard every night. You know, another person that's proven to be quite an asset that everybody said that the Pirates overpaid for, maybe they did, is Russell Martin. Russell Martin has been amazing so far, catcher. He hit another, he hit his second home run last night. But what was it, in Sunday's game, okay, the Pirates were up 3-2 over Atlanta. Runner on first, no out, and the runner on first takes off. Pitcher throws the pitch, strikes out the batter. Russell Martin throws out the runner for the second time in the game, a strikeout throw out. So now all of a sudden he turned a strikeout into a double play. The very next batter up hit a double. So, you know, what happens was he got stranded on second. Martin doesn't throw that runner out, still on second. It's a tie game, and it's a completely different complexion on the game. Pirates ended up winning the game 4-2. So, you know, he has thrown out more runners in the month of April, and it's only April the 23rd, than Rod Barajas throughout all of last year. Now, you know, last year when the Pirates went into the tank and they were swirling the bowl, and I was there clinging on the edge trying to get down to help them up. You know, the Milwaukee Brewers came into town and they showed everybody how exactly you beat the Pirates last year. They ran. They probably stole six bases a game. And there was nothing the Pirates could do about it. And that was part of the problem was the pitchers. The pitchers weren't making any attempt to hold the runners on. And the catcher couldn't throw out my mother. God rest her soul. She passed away in October. But so now we've got a catcher in there that can actually throw out runners. That's taking that dimension out of the game. And, you know, the Pirates are a better team for it.
And, Chip, I want to tell you, after drinking that sour Kool-Aid, I am on the Pirate bandwagon right now. Even though they lost yesterday, it was A.J. Burnett, but I'm on the bandwagon officially.
This just in.
We got a Brazil.
Woo, my baby. But I just want to get something in. Hey, please let all the fans know where we're going to be on Sunday.
This is part of what I was going to do. But we're talking baseball. So we'll bring it up. I can't hold off now. You're teasing them. And we can't tease our fans here because they're watching hockey and baseball. Speaking of baseball, where's the place at, though? It's in Sewickley. I don't have an address for the field.
Wow.
Nobody gave me the address. They're actually building a stand.
Claudio, if you're watching, get Alan the address. We'll be there to broadcast.
We got a late-breaking news report. Aaron Ward in our control room does have the address.
Great.
We will have that location locked up for you. I'll try to announce something on Pittsburgh Sports Line on our Facebook page, Big Mike, since you're a fan of ours.
Big fan.
Big fan. And that's CMU playing St. Francis at noon. So we're going to have the Pittsburgh Sports Line crew there.
Claudio is a friend of the show.
Right.
Jim's long lost brother.
From a different mother. They and, even said that.
We're going to broadcast from the CMU baseball game and support one of our local colleges. You know, and a couple of the other local colleges that are playing pretty lights out baseball, Point Park College.
Yes.
And the University of Pittsburgh.
Really?
They've been playing very well. Last week they swept the Notre Dame.
The Kamikaze Kid must not be a catcher there anymore.
No, he's not. Matter of fact, the Kamikaze Kid just come out to eat steak at Sips Sports Bar and watch our show. He's a big fan. And if you didn't see the video from last night, we had a first-time event for the Kamikaze Kid. He has a smartphone, unlike my dumb phone. He actually saw YouTube and our show where he was the first guest, and he said, it's a great show, guys.
I'll tell you what, he has some great stories. He was Tony Dorsett's roommate on the road when he was in college. Had some great inside stories about some of the glory days of Pitt football.
Yes, he did.
I'll tell you what, very interesting interview, and I really enjoy talking to him. And his passion for the University of Pittsburgh, second to none.
I wonder who was Will Chamberlain's roommate on the road.
10,000 different.
What I didn't ever understood was a man that was so successful with so many ladies. Why was his name Wilt?
Is that more than
sometimes? Just a little thought. Sometimes the parents inspire their kids by naming him a different type of name. So maybe that inspired him. And as we're winding down, we didn't mention the Penguins except briefly. And I heard Malkin's going to be playing. Fleury supposed to play?
Well, Fleury sat out last night's game because they let him stay in Pittsburgh. His wife's about ready to give birth. I don't know if she's given birth yet. I don't know if he's going to play tonight. But, you know, I mean, right now, the main thing for the Penguins is get healthy. I mean, right now, they sent their backup team to Ottawa, playing against a team that must win. They needed to win to stay in the playoff hunt. And the Penguins sat an all-star team. The six players that they sat are probably the six best players in the NHL. And they left them at home, and the Penguins still beat the Ottawa Senators. So, I mean, they're clicking on all cylinders. And, you know,
Stanley Cup. We need 16 wins in the Stanley Cup.
16 wins. That's
all
it takes.
Big Mike.
That's all it takes.
I love Tommy VC.
Pardon me?
I love Tommy VC.
Are you talking your Vietnam days?
No.
Well, I'm
Tommy the goaltender, the backup, who is smoother than silk, man.
Hey, we're going to start wrapping this up. Big Mike, what else do you have to promote here?
I'm going drinking tonight.
Pirate
Kool-Aid.
That's right.
With no sugar.
You know what, Big Mike, I got to tell you, you know, you can get tickets available to the best ballpark in the country, and you don't have to spend $350 to go to that toilet in New York.
Wow, you shouldn't have talked before the show. Smoking Jim, what else do you have to close with here, buddy?
Pittsburgh Steelers will make me happy if they go to Africa and get Ezekiel. His nickname is Ziggy. Oh, we get a Ziggy that can really
Ziggy
play
two.
Now. Ziggy 2 on Saul. That will really make me happy. Or if they go to SMU and get my man 6'8", 285 pounds, does 38 reps. With those long arms at 2.25, Marcus Hunt from Estonia. He's from Estonia.
Wow.
And he's still got the national junior discus shot put record. So very, very great guy to bring on the team as well.
Foreigners. Thanks, Smoking Jim. And I hope you can stay in the war room to at least get your steak.
Oh, I get that before.
Okay.
I get that before. As soon
yeah,
as
before
I go
you
in,
start making off.
That's it. They got all black folks, brother.
And Smoking Jim does a nice job at eating. He tries to be like a shy type of guy. And we were at the Hall of Fame dinner at the Royal Place. Great meal. Just fantastic. Thanks to Smoking Jim for that. I wanted to at least get that in there. We had a great time there with Andy Sebastian, Jimmy Savetic. You know, if you ever need Jimmy Savetic, 412-298-7373. He said, call. You can get tickets to his events. He's happy to have you there. You just can't bribe him. He told people they're trying to bribe him to get in the Hall of Fame. It didn't work out for him.
Don't forget we had cheese and ham on him.
Yeah, and shout out to Terry and Devin for being there with me. They put up with Smoking Jim and all his humor there. And it was a little bit of humor. So we had a good time. Chip, what do you want to close with here, my friend?
You know what? Wouldn't it be poetic justice if the Penguins ended up playing the Ottawa Senators in the first round of the playoffs?
Yes.
That's just one of the things I think.
I like what you're thinking there. And I really don't care who they play, because I've said since the beginning, and I think a few of us have agreed, Stanley Cup, it's our year. It's sort of like 93, but we're going to win it all. And they've played a heck of a season so far, and I believe they'll win it. I want to thank everybody for watching the show. We appreciate your support. We appreciate you telling us, you know, how you enjoy the show and all the nice remarks that we hear out in the public. So thanks again. Thanks to Dave Cable and BPTV for letting us produce boxing matches, baseball now, more boxing, and we just enjoy
Sip
it.
Sip,
yeah, I can't forget Sip Sports Line, 3024 West Liberty Avenue. Come on up there Monday night. Get there around 7:30. You can eat before we start taping our show. If you have some sports questions, come on out. We'll give you 20 seconds of fame. You could be on the show.
We might even answer your questions.
Well, that's possible. Thanks to Devin Shea. Appreciate the camera work here. I did wake him up so we can get out the door. And Aaron Ward, thanks for all you do in the control room and for last night with all the filming that you do. Thanks again, guys.